4 years ago, a quiet memoir about an impoverished Irish family took the publishing world by storm. It was called Angela's Ashes. It earned a Pulitzer Prize for first-time author Frank McCourt. The years that followed saw a surge of interest in all things Irish, from literature to dance to film, and behind it all seemed to be some member of the McCourt family. Now, Frank McCourt has published the second part of his memoirs called Tis, and it begins where Angela's Ashes left off, with a 19-year-old Frank setting sail for New York City. I am pleased at any time to have him on this broadcast, and especially to have him back at this table in the publication of this memoir. Welcome back.
Thank you, Charlie.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
I just saw you on 60 Minutes,
yeah.
The inaugural program
of
the season. That's it. I mean, that's about the equivalent of a Pulitzer Prize in America.
Canonization.
Canonization would be appropriate.
I don't know what to do after that.
Now, first of all, but let's talk about history, and then we'll get to this book. The movie of Angela's Ashes. You've seen it? Have you seen parts of it?
I've seen the whole thing.
Oh, you like it?
It'll be out on Christmas Day.
Right.
And it's wonderful. I saw her small screening with my wife, Ellen, and the producers, Scott Rudin and David Brown, and there were tears. Oh, there's laughter, too, but I think it's Alan Parker directed, and I think he captured it. He has a sense of humor, he has a sense of the grit, and he has a strong sense of music, so all these combined. And then Emily Watson playing my mother.
She plays Angela.
Yeah, and Robert Carlyle playing my father. So there's great, what did we say in the business? Chemistry. Powerful chemistry there. I'm learning.
Who wrote the screenplay?
A lady named Laura Jones in Australia. Yeah. But then Alan Parker, being a very independent type of character, he takes it and rewrites it. Because she was very sensitive and tender. She brought out that part of the book.
Emily did.
Laura Jones. But yeah. Then Alan comes along, because he comes from the back streets of England somewhere. He knew what the movie needed. So he gives it that gritty feel. And it does have that. And you sit there, you write a book about your life, then they make it into a movie, you sit there watching it. And it's a strange experience. It's looking into receding mirrors or something. And I didn't know what to feel. But there were certain parts of it where I think I was drawn into the screen, drawn back into my life, and it hit me in the stomach. There's one scene in particular, which I could hardly bear to watch.
Which scene was that?
There's a scene where when I'm 16 years old, I have my first pint of Guinness.
Yes.
And I come home, three sheets to the wind, and I'm very arrogant, and there's a confrontation with my mother, and I slapped her face. A thing that I will regret to my dying day. But that scene, I felt so guilty at the screening that day. I nearly collapsed, and I just it was harrowing to see that, to see all the things that I've, that the silly things that I did, and my mistakes on the screen. So it was brought home to me. It's a very I won't say it's therapeutic, but it's to be confronted with yourself is a very harrowing experience.
To see it on that big a screen,
yeah,
in the sense that they captured the authenticity of your story.
Oh, they got it, because I think a lot of people are in Ireland particularly are going to be offended by the authenticity, the sordidness of a lot of it, with the conditions that in the house that we grew up in. But Alan Parker got it.
I've read or heard that they couldn't actually film the thing and Limerick, because it's no longer as bad as that, so they had to go to Dublin.
Limerick is booming.
Yeah.
Limerick, there's another town called Ennis, and between Limerick and Ennis, which is about 12 miles away, there's a new computer industry. It's the Silicon Valley of Ireland.
Yes.
With a drizzle.
Silicon. Damp silicon.
So it's very, so they had to, they went around Limerick looking for a slum.
Yeah.
But they had to build one in Dublin. And I went to this place, and I thought, Jesus, this is eerie. I didn't know at first that it was a reproduction until you saw the props behind.
I want to get to this, but for people who don't know, Angela's Ashes is about the story of you and your family, born in the United States, going back to Limerick, and what you had to endure, then your father going away, and your mother, and your family, and what is it that makes it so powerful that it's so, what, 3 million, 4 million copies?
Well, it's about 5 million, worldwide now.
A movie
made
you an international celebrity.
Yeah. And put a few dollars in the bank.
A few dollars in the bank is...
So I don't have to worry about that anymore.
Yeah.
I, I can give to the charity of my choice.
Yes.
But I don't know what it is. A lot of people say, well, why is this book so successful? Yeah. I was writing it 5 years ago, I think. And I didn't know. I didn't know I'd even be able to publish it. So finally it was accepted by Scribner, and they printed 27,000 copies. And if you had one of those, now it's worth $600, one that first edition.
First edition of Benjamin's Ashes is $600.
Yeah. But and then it took off for some reason. And the ingredients of something like that, I'm always interested in ingredients. Family, poverty, religion, sex to a certain extent, and adversity and how, and style and humor, all of these ingredients got to make up this what it has become. Yeah. And people's alcoholism is one of the big things. The people write to me from all over saying they begin to understand the alcoholism in their family, and that people in their families have begun to talk, especially the Irish. You know, the Irish have a reputation for being mercurial and talkative. Yes. But you keep it on a political level. You don't get too close to the human heart. But now, and they tell me people, their fathers and their parents and grandparents are now beginning to talk, whereas they wouldn't talk before about the circumstances they came from. So now it's, as I say, it gives them permission to talk about the what they came from.
Most people know your story, and certainly after 60 Minutes they know it better. It is a story of a man who comes to America, shaves his head because they told you he had lice and all this kind of stuff, doing jobs. Finally, you find a place, which is teaching. You didn't become a cop and you didn't become a barkeeper, you became a teacher at Peter Stuyvesant.
Yeah, Stuyvesant, yeah.
Could you have written that book without the influence of those kids constantly sort of reinforcing you about your story?
Standing in front of the class was where I learned anything I know. Well, I had my own experiences of menial jobs at the Biltmore Hotel and so on, and being in the army and training German shepherds and then becoming a company clerk and then going to NYU. But finally, when I went into the classroom, I went in a bit naive, like an Irish schoolmaster. I mean, that was my only model for teaching, these tough schoolmasters we had with the stick and the strap and the cane who knocked the hell out of us. So I was going to go in there and I was going to be an Irish schoolmaster. Well, they soon straightened me out in McKee Vocational High School in Staten Island. Yo, teach, why are you talking like that? Hey, sit down. I'd sit down. Hey, teach, don't talk to me like that. And because some of there were members of the football team who could have broken me in two. So I learned to adjust. I mean, I didn't dominate the class. I learned to adjust to them. That was my first lesson. And then I learned how to reach them. And it's if you consider the average high school teacher in Stuyvesant High School, places like that, that you have five classes a day, you have 170 kids, and you have, first of all, remember all those names, and you have to remember particular things about each kid, and you might go into the classroom in the morning, first class starting at 8:10, and you're not feeling too good because you've been out half the night in the Lion's Head having a few beers. Some nights were like that, but some days you're not in the mood for it and you're cranky, but you have to adjust. And I had to learn, I had to drop the mask, that's what it was. We all wear the mask, and I was wearing the teacher mask. But bit by bit, what I found out was teenagers demand honesty. It doesn't matter what they're like, their hijinks and the trouble they cause. They want you to be honest with them. And they get very little of it. They get very little of it from teachers or parents or the media or anybody else. And you know they in five or six months that you have these particular classes, you've been stripped away and they're sitting there. That's, you know, 135 kids in a class, these horny boys and these sex-crazed girls, and they're worried about their zits and their figures and everything else and their hair. Yeah. And they're like, and they're watching you, and they're looking for your defects and your vulnerabilities, and they're like little heat-seeking missiles. Hey, Mr. McCourt, you don't look too good today, huh? You out last night? That kind of thing. And Mr. McCourt, your hair is a mess. Come up to Beauty Culture Shop and we'll do you. So that's what it was like. And you learn. I was thrown into it. Yeah. Nobody told me anything about teaching. I was just thrown into it and had to deal with it. And I knew nothing about American teenagers. I was a newcomer, except what I'd seen in the movies. And my experience was Andy Hardy when I was a kid, Mickey Rooney, and Kelly Girl. Let's do the show right here. So then here they are sitting in front of me, and they're tough. And they know, and this is the way, these kids are experienced. They're experienced students, and they're masters of psychology when it comes to teachers. They size you up.
Yeah. And you better be up to it.
Yeah.
But it also makes you honest, because you can't get away with it if you're not honest.
No.
If you try to fool them, then it ends up in it.
I learned to say, I don't know. You know, if you come to a poem, a Dylan Thomas poem or a Hopkins poem, I don't know. Well, hey, Mr. McCourt, what does this mean? I don't know. What do you think it means?
We're
looking at it together.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't know when you're the teacher?
Yeah. You don't know when you're the teacher.
Right.
Yeah, right. When you wrote that, did you say to yourself, this is only part of the story. As soon as I finish this, this is enough for now. I'll write either the sequel or the prequel later.
To what?
To Angela's Ashes.
Yeah, when I finished Angela's Ashes, I didn't know I'd be writing another book. I wanted to get that one out of my system, the one about growing up in Ireland. I wanted to show something about poverty. But I didn't know I'd want to write another book about coming to America and the effects of that poverty on a young immigrant.
Then whose idea was it? Was it your idea or was it your publisher who said the story is too compelling not to carry forward?
Well, a lot of people were saying, what happened to you and your family?
Yeah.
And some people complained that there were pages missing at the end of the book, and they were writing to Scribners and demanding their money back because the last chapter is one word.
Yeah.
Tis. Somebody says to me in chapter 18, Jesus, Frank, isn't this a great country? Turn the page. Tis. So I use that as the title for the next book.
Now, you wrote this book on the go, because you've been on this program when you were writing this book, and you told me I'm working on this book. So you probably did it in the busiest time of your existence.
Angela's Ashes was written in relative serenity, peace and quiet over in Pennsylvania. Tears was written on trains, planes, buses, airport lounges, toilet seats, anywhere I could find it.
Well, that can't be good for writing, then.
Well, I was looking, rereading this biography of James Joyce by Richard Ellman, which is a masterly biography. And at one point, Joyce said, I can write anywhere. And he did Zurich, Trieste, Paris, wherever he was, in the worst circumstances. And that lit a little fire in my head. There's no excuse for not writing. Because some writers have to have, Hemingway had to have a desk and a podium. He'd write narrative at the podium, then he'd come back to the desk and write dialogue, back and forth. No wonder he killed himself. He was exhausted going back and forth between the two.
He killed himself because he couldn't put anything on the page anymore.
That's what it was. And I don't understand that, because as long as you write, you always have something to write about. I don't think you can exhaust the vein at all. Because as I used to say to my students, as divers, the minute you become a writer, you're never bored again. Because everything is fascinating. Everybody you look at.
Because everything also, you're putting it into some big bin, which may be for recall in order to feed the thing that you do now, which is to observe and write and remember and write and think about and write.
Yeah.
Right?
Everything is fascinating. Everything is a mystery. So that's...
How do you know if it's fascinating to you but not to me?
Well, that's my job, then, to convey it to you.
Yeah, yeah. And that's also skill.
That's skill, and that's passion.
Now, do you come down on this notion that writers are born or made, or any of that sort of stuff?
I think you're born, and then there's a culture you grow up in which cherishes language.
Yeah.
Because if I grew up if I had been of a later generation, I might have taken up the guitar and put on the tight black leather pants and the earring, and I'd be strumming away and blah, blah.
You also say if you'd had a lot of success early, that you might not have been able to handle it.
No, I wouldn't have been able to handle
it. Too many women, too many bars, too many everything.
I said once that if this had happened to me, 25, I'd be dead of whiskey and fornication. So that's not going to happen now. The whiskey, maybe.
Is this book as good as Angela's Ashes?
I like it because I think it's more ambitious. And what I like about it, it's an American book, and it deals with the rhythms of American life, different cast of characters. It's not a one culture book the way Angela's Ashes was. And I sometimes pick it up and I read, and I'd buy it. I'd give it to people for Christmas.
Was it easier to write because...
No.
You were in the rhythm of writing and you knew how to write?
That's the thing, the rhythm and the voice. I have found the voice with Angela's Ashes.
Yeah.
So that was a big problem solved. But the rhythm of Tis is different from the rhythm of Angel's Ashes, which is, in a sense, a quieter, more desperate book with hope. You know, the desire to get out of that slum in Limerick and to see the New York, dreaming of the New York skyline. That was our main dream, which I achieved. But then once you get here, then it's a, I think Tis is mostly a story about bewilderment. You arrive in the city.
You didn't arrive in the city, you arrived in Albany.
I arrived in Albany and then had to take the train down to
like a priest brings you down.
That's right, yeah. You know? And he
takes you to a hotel and makes a pass at you.
Yeah.
And you were how old?
19. Shocked. I don't know how, I didn't realize how deeply shocked I was because I'd grown up in Ireland, a Catholic and the rest of it. And that was practically shaking the edifice of the Vatican for me. I didn't lose faith completely, but that was the beginning of it. And that was, and of course it had happened to a lot of people in Ireland as they're discovering now. You can't pick up the Irish Times without reading about some priest going after a little boy or a little girl. Some people are suing for things that happened 35 years ago. Some priest got into the bed of a young 16-year-old girl in the hospitals. So they're suing. But that was one of the big shocks for me. And of course, New York was a shock.
Yeah.
I couldn't deal with it.
You lost whatever self-esteem you had pretty quick, didn't you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I was angry. But I had to, I also had some kind of stubbornness which forced me to think about going to college. I wouldn't settle for less. I wasn't going to go into construction or the bar business or the police or anything like that. No,
Why was that?
Because I would see these kids on the subway with their Columbia University book jackets and their jackets and so on. And I said, that's what I want. I want to go to college. There was an element of snobbery in it, but I also said, they're up there, they're learning things that I want to know. So I had to do that. And I wouldn't have been satisfied if I hadn't gone to college. And then later on in life, I would not have been satisfied if I hadn't written Angela's Ashes. I would have died howling. I would have begged for another year so that I could write that book.
And rage
against the dying. Yeah.
Dylan Thomas.
Yeah.
You would have been that way when you died if you hadn't written the book.
I would have been howling, yeah. I would have been very unhappy because I knew that was the one thing, all the years of teaching, 30 years in the classroom, that was the thing that I had to do all those years.
God, when you say that, I think about the people who don't have that satisfaction. The number of people.
Yeah. The dreamers.
The dreamers.
Yeah.
Who did not, in the end, even grasp for a moment whatever the brass ring in their head was.
Yeah, they didn't follow their bliss.
And so they rage, you know.
Yeah. And they die bitter and unhappy. But I don't know what it was what circumstances forced me to postpone the writing of this, and I spent those years, very rich, valuable years as a teacher.
When you got to know writers.
I got to know writers because I hung around the Lion's Head bar in the village, and they were all writers and journalists. Pete Hamill and Joe Flaherty and Norman Mailer would come in there and so on. So I was always on the periphery. I was always on the fringe looking at, which is a good place for a writer to be. Though I didn't write much about the Lion's Head yet. Not yet, no. The next one is a novel. The next one is a novel, yeah.
And the Lion's Head will be one of the
The Lion's Head will be a major.
Really?
Yeah.
What can you tell me without sort of screwing
up
for you?
Well, the Lion's Head was there for 30 years.
I know the Lion's Head. What can you tell me about the novel?
Oh, it's about
writers?
It's bewilderment continued. It's about, I think, the two levels of my life, teaching and women. Mm. The two great, well, women being the last great mystery for me, anyway.
For me,
I don't care about space. I still can't. Freud said that after 30 years of treating women, the question remains, what do they want? I don't know.
And we don't know yet.
But I tried to give them what they want, and I don't know what they want.
So the next book is about that in part?
Yeah, it's an exploration.
One of the great mysteries of life.
Yeah, I think...
Bewilderment and what do women want?
Yeah, and teaching.
And teaching.
What goes on in a classroom fascinates me now in retrospect. Because I think I was in the classroom for 30 years, and 15 years, for the first 15 years, I was learning. I was becoming developing a style in the classroom, and telling the kids about writing, simplicity and clarity, but not taking that advice myself when I went home to write. And then eventually, when in the last 15 years, I felt comfortable in the class and I was making all kinds of discoveries. That's what I want to write about.
Yeah. Now, one of the criticisms of this is, first of all, people are going to read this, Tiz, and they're going to say, is it as good as Angel's Ashes? That's the first thing in their head, don't you think?
Yeah.
That's the first question. Yeah. You know, they may like it more, they may like it less, they may say it's different but equally compelling.
Yeah.
Some of the critics, or one at least, made note of the fact that this lacks the innocence that came out of the voice in Angel's Ashes.
Are you supposed to be an idiot into your 20s and 30s, the idiot that I was when I was a kid in Ireland, where I knew nothing, where I was under the thrall of the Catholic Church and the rest of it in poverty? Yeah. You come to this country and you have your adventures. And I tried to write it from the point of view of what I was then, not me. I'm not attacking anything now myself. Yeah. But I was always whining and bitching and moaning about what I saw in front of me. The young people in the lounge of the Biltmore Hotel who were all in the Ivy League. These golden, long-legged Episcopalian girls that I coveted.
And got lusted for was the word you used.
Lusted, yeah. So, of course, it doesn't have the innocence of Angel's Ashes, but it has a lot of disillusionment about
America.
But
this is closer to you, too, than Angel's Ashes has, in a sense. You can be almost detached and innocent and observing and finely tuned. Here is closer to your...
Yeah, it's more recent. It has a larger cast of characters and a more diverse type of people. You know, New York, Jewish, black, and everything else, so... I had to handle all of that, and the rhythms of American talk and life and the little dangers that I found along the way and that I had to react to. And especially considering my own makeup, my own emotional makeup, I wasn't prepared. But bit by bit, I was learning, and that's what it is.
A lot of stuff has come out of what you writing Angel's Ashes. I mean, you and your brother were here with me. You wrote a book together.
Yeah.
There have been documentaries on Showtime about the family.
Yeah,
this is like a cottage industry, the adventures of the McCourt family.
It happened very late for us, for Malachy and me. I'm the bright shining hope of the Social Security set. Arise from your armchair and write your memoir.
Exactly. Well, there is something to be said for that. The interesting thing about you is that you had command of language, number one, and you had a great memory for your experience, too. Yeah. I mean, those things are a potent combination if done well.
Well, people are always saying, how do you remember all of that? What fascinates me is what we forget, not what we remember. Because when you grow up as I did, everything was traumatic and dramatic. We didn't grow up in comfort. Yeah. So that any little comfort that came in, you know, a ham sandwich was a monumental feast.
You remember that.
I remember these particular moments. Epiphanies, Joyce called it, these particular moments that were so revealing and so significant. That I used to say to myself when I was a kid, I will never forget this moment for one reason or another.
Because it's so different,
sometimes it was bliss, or sometimes it was something. My mother, for instance, she had to beg, and I saw her outside this priest's house in Limerick begging, and I knew. I didn't say consciously, I'll never forget this moment, but I knew that image was imprinted on my mind forever.
Seeing
and I would never
beg.
Forget. Yeah.
Where are you today in sense of your father? Where have you come to?
Well, after writing about him in Tiz, he died. He died in 1985. My mother died 4 years before that. So I realized he had his demons. He shouldn't have been married. The worst thing that ever happened to my mother was meeting him. You see this all the time, people meeting him, and they shouldn't. They should just.
They should have gone
on opposite directions, and it was unfortunate for him.
Because they weren't good for each other.
No, he was an alcoholic. He wasn't a daily alcoholic. It's when he got money, and then the money is there in his pocket, and the thirst begins, and off he goes. And I saw him in Belfast, two or three times in the 70s. And the early 80s before he died. Then he Then I went to his funeral. Why, I don't know. Why did I go to the funeral of this man who abandoned us when I was 10 or 11? And there he's lying in the coffin. And that's my father, shriveled. And he looked, and I started laughing. I knelt on this needle by the coffin with my brother Alfie. They all thought I was sobbing, but I was, because he looked like a seagull. I thought, Jesus, and his nose was out and his teeth had been taken out, and he looked just like a seagull. And I was trying to control my laughter and hear him. And then the family arranged around looking at me because I'm the chief mourner. So we all went outside, and I had to go back in again because I had to, apologize to him for laughing. I had to say a prayer for him.
So what did you say? I'm sorry.
I said, I'm sorry.
Because I know this is your last moment.
And I said three Hail Marys for him. Yeah.
And the church, where are you with the church today?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, it's a great big buffet. All the religions are out there, and I take what I want. But as far as the Catholic Church is concerned, I think it's not that I'm going back to the church. It's just that I'm more and more fascinated with it, with this 2,000-year-old institution that has such power over it. And it's always the best show in town. The rituals of the Catholic Church.
You know, I was just reading on the plane back last night from Seattle. I was reading this article or an excerpt from this book about Pope Pius the 12th.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. 11th, I think it is. 11th or 12th, I can't remember. But it was amazing to me.
Yeah.
And the machinations.
Yeah.
And the politics. Yeah. And the intrigue.
Yeah. The power.
And the power.
Somebody said to me, I was in Rome a few months ago, and there are 250 churches in Rome, and they're all being renovated for next year, for the Jubilee year, and a lot of people are complaining that other things need taken care of in Rome, but said, the Pope said he wants all those churches done, and that's what he said.
Pope says he likes them clean, yeah. We'll clean them.
Yeah.
No, why? The Pope said he'd like it done. Frank McCourt, Pulitzer Prize-winning author of the number one New York Times bestseller, Angela's Ashes, soon to be a major motion picture in December, starring Emily Watson, directed by Alan Parker. Here it is. That's you, what, at age?
19.
Yeah.
That was a snapshot somebody took. And then, I had black hair then and everything. And
yeah, when did it turn?
I think the teaching did it to me.
The kids did it, huh?
Yeah, the kids did it. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, kids.
But when you like to talk about your life and think about your life, man, in a sense, success late might be better.
I think it is because it's a novelty to me.
Yeah. You know,
because I was an obscure high school teacher, nobody paid me any attention, then you write a book and you're consulted about everything and you're on television and everything.
The other thing,
you know what's very sweet about it? After all those years of teaching and talking about literature and writing, I think, you know, if you're a kid in a high school and you have a phys ed teacher and you see they're out of shape and you say, why are they telling me about exactly. Running and jumping?
Right. Right.
And the same thing with writing. A teacher's up there talking about writing, and the kid is saying, well, what, you're up there, why aren't you writing?
Yeah.
Tell me, why are you telling me? Exactly. So it's very gratifying now when I meet former students of mine. And they said, and one of them I met this morning, she said, we all knew you'd be successful.
Oh, that's great.
I take that one in the spirit that it was intended.
Yeah, right. Once again, Frank McCourt, Tiz, thank you, my friend.
Thank you,
great to see you. Thank you. Come back anytime.
Anytime.
We'll be right back. Stay with us. In a 60-year career that began before the age of television, Hugh Downs has reported everywhere from the North Pole to the South Pole. He holds a Guinness World Record for most hours logged on network commercial television. He has hosted such television institutions as the game show Concentration and the Today Show and the Tonight Show. But for the past 21 years, he could be found on ABC's news magazine show 2020.
There were a lot of profiles done over the years. With Zubin Mehta and the New York Philharmonic touring his homeland in India. The Dalai Lama talked with me about his exile from Tibet. And one of my favorite interviews was the time I spent in Cambridge, England, with the theoretical physicist Stephen Hawking, who suffers from Lou Gehrig's disease, and speaks through the aid of a computer.
We all need to know where we come from and what may happen in the future. Otherwise, Life just seems pointless.
That it, whatever that it was in me, had a name.
The it actress Patty Duke is talking about is manic depression. In this moving interview, she told me how this mental illness led to her suicide attempts.
When you really took steps to do that, what happened? What did you do?
It's very odd to sit here and answer you and look down the hallway and know that that's the bedroom. That's the bed from which I could not get up unless it was to go in and attempt suicide.
Covering adventure stories let me be more than a reporter. I became a cowboy in the Great West in search of wild Mustangs to tame.
I volunteered to go in there with you and help you, and that would only louse things up.
You want to go in there first? Yeah, that's fine.
Now, Alma, what's our speed now?
I was a space shuttle commander during a landing exercise in NASA's motion-based simulator.
Houston, we do not have a problem.
And even experienced weightlessness on board what NASA affectionately calls the Vomit Comet. Yeah.
This Friday marks Hugh Downs' final appearance on 2020. He joins me now for a conversation about a rather remarkable career in communications. Welcome back to the program.
Well, thank you, Joe.
You said to me as we watched Stephen Hawking, still alive at Cambridge, I think, that he may be as smart as Einstein.
A lot of physicists think that, and some think he might be slightly smarter because, and I got a glimpse into that cauldron of the mind. I spent four evenings in his home in Cambridge, and he, like many great people, was willing to spend time talking to me when he sensed that I was sincerely interested in what he was doing. And it was fascinating.
How did he communicate, through the computer?
Yeah, he has the use of two fingers and a wrist on the other hand. And with that, he could operate his wheelchair and this computer. Very sophisticated cybernetic thing that allows him to speak.
And what's he's obviously at Cambridge thinking about big ideas.
Yeah. He pointed out a silver lining. Wouldn't you think you'd go nuts if you were in that awful prison and not being able to move? He said to me, if I were able-bodied, I would have to take my children to ball games and attend social functions. He said, but as it is, I can be excused for spending all of my time thinking about advanced theoretical physics. Yeah. And I thought that was a very, very interesting.
Reynolds Price, who was in a wheelchair too because of he had cancer in the spine, they had to radiate, and then he lost, obviously, his mobility. In a wheelchair, says he's been more creative since that happened.
Isn't that astounding?
Than he has before.
Says something about the human spirit, doesn't it?
Yeah.
How we adapt to various things.
You're stepping down from 2020.
Yep. I have mixed feelings about that, obviously. But, you know, my tenure has come of age. A child born the day I started on 2020 could vote now. I think it's time to move on to some other really challenging things.
Well, I'll talk about what you're going to move to, but let me just share that experience. I remember when 2020 started on the air, and it was Robert Hughes. And who was the other guy? I forgot.
Harold Hayes.
And Harold Hayes, who's deceased, I think.
Yeah,
he was a former editor of Esquire and I think a North Carolinian, maybe from the South.
He was from the South.
And Robert Hughes were from Australia. And Rune Arledge had this idea that he'd take these two cultural figures who you probably knew, because Rune is an extraordinary producer.
I'll tell you the truth, Charlie, I don't think that was Rune's idea. Rune had been, it had been suggested to Rune that as a president of a division that he not do hands-on line production. And he took that to heart. And left that group to devise what they did, and then wanted to see what they had come up with shortly before they went on the air. I think within 48 hours, and realized that it was pretty bad. And then he got into it and made real attempts to improve it. But at that late date, it probably made it even worse. You know, and those two guys tapped to be anchors were very worthy individuals, but neither had any television experience. Or were known to the general public.
Right.
In a way, I always thought of that as not fully understanding what we do as anchors.
As communicators.
Yeah. Because I think they think just you sit there and talk, and that's all there is to it.
So where were you when he was doing this experimentation with this new program called 2020, trying to do what 60 Minutes had done, become an American television institution, which it in fact did. Where were you? You were in Arizona then in retirement?
I was in Arizona. I was in what the press insisted on calling retirement and out of regular television. And
but
my wife and I.
Your answer to that was you were doing more than you'd ever done in terms of all the curiosity you had.
That is true. But my wife and I were in New York on other business and
checked into the Regency for 1 week, and we were there 18 months. That's a fact. Such right angle turns.
So through your agent, Room found you and said, look, I got a problem here. You need to come in next Friday and start
this
show.
That's exactly right. And I've been on it since the second one.
Yeah. And then you did it alone for 6 years?
Yeah, about five and a half years. And Barbara was not available. Barbara contributed occasionally to the program with pieces that were, as usual, brought prestige and share points to it. But she was tied up at that time with Harry Reasoner doing the nightly news, you know. And
an unhappy experience for her.
Yeah, that was not too happy for her. But then later on, as a matter of fact, first thing I did was tell Barbara when the company said they wanted to make her co-host, I thought, let's not fix it if it isn't broken, you know. And I said, why don't we leave things as they are? And so I finally agreed to try it for 6 months. If it worked, fine. And as I later told Barbara, I was very glad to have been wrong because it worked very, very well, and I enjoy working with her.
What's the chemistry between the two of you? I mean, it goes back to the Today Show when you were the star, you were the host, and
yeah,
she was...
and she came on the air and was... Actually, Barbara was probably more of a star. Barbara is a star. I'm just a communicator. But we worked well together on Today also, and she later became co-host of Today after 4 years after I left, I think, when Frank McGee died. We don't know what the chemistry is. There's a strange thing. First of all, we have different styles of working. If you work together with a co-anchor and have exactly the same style, it's kind of inbred. You know? We have different styles. We have had differences of opinion, but never any rancor, and that's the truth.
Over the famous Marv Albert incident?
No rancor. It was a little jarring, and I think it may have worried her, and it worried me that I upset her about that. But I couldn't be there when the Marv Albert thing was on.
Remember what happened? I mean, Marv Albert had, for all of the sort of tabloid coverage we know, because of what had happened to him, he had to give up his job at NBC Sports, and a lot of attention in the tabloids. It was sad. It was a sad story. And then what?
Oh, well, then I was a guest on Larry King's show, and Larry said...
You were a guest.
Yeah. And Larry said, would you interview Marv Albert? And I said, no, I don't want to. And he said, would you let Barbara do it? And I said, Barbara wouldn't do it. I thought that maybe she wouldn't. And I got back, and Barbara said, Victor would like to do it, and he's got it locked in. And I said, oh, man, I don't want to get on the air and denounce the situation on my own program. Yeah. And so the best thing was for me to be away, and there was no hard feelings about that. And
did the program take notice of the fact that you were away because of that?
Yeah, and the thing is, we tried to keep it secret, but somebody went out to the press that it was a big thing, and I didn't want anything made of it. Later, when Barbara did a really marvelous interview with Monica Lewinsky, and she was a little bit concerned that I might want to boycott that, but I said, you know, this is different. Monica Lewinsky was involved with a sitting president, and the public has a right to know all that you can know about that. And she brought it out beautifully, and I think tastefully even. So that was very different from Marv Albert. I said to a reporter once that I thought all of the attention that Marv Albert was getting should have focused on his considerable talents as a sportscaster and not on the sordid aspect of his life. But such is the kind of tabloid pressure that gets on us.
Does it bother you, or does it worry you, or does you think it's healthy for the proliferation of so many television magazine shows? I mean, there are a bunch of Datelines now. 2020 has three or four incarnations. 60 Minutes now has two.
Well, you know, it's easy to explain. I think that pendulum may swing back a little bit. But it represents two things, I think. One is that television, what television is all about is not what the Academy or TV Guide thinks it is, all showbiz. And they say, oh, yeah, and then there is news. They do news. As though that's and I think the tail wags the dog, and the public is beginning to realize that what's real about television, you know, it's not improper for television to do entertainment, but there are other media that do, you know, there's stage, there's movies that do entertainment very well. Nothing does what television does in the way of conversations, in the way of coverage of events that are happening, you know, window on the world idea. So there's the increase in the number of magazines represents that. And I think also, when you think from a business standpoint, if you owned a network and you had a sitcom that was in trouble, and you knew that to mount a new one would cost maybe three times as much as a good magazine, and that the magazine would get better numbers, you're going to put another magazine in.
Sure.
And that's what they've
done. Well, it costs less to produce, too. You
know, that's right.
The idea of and secondly, this is less significant now, but in the past, you owned it. I mean, so 60 Minutes was owned by CBS News, and 2020 was owned by ABC News. Whereas all those other sitcoms in the past have been programs they bought.
Shop,
but
right.
That's all changing now because CBS is owned by Viacom, which also owns Paramount.
Isn't that amazing?
And ABC is owned by Disney, which has all those production houses. Here's what fascinates me about you. It is always the Catholicity, if that's a word, the Catholic interest that you have. You have always been a man who was a broadcaster, which was a skill you had. But over here was something that frequently didn't have anything to do with you as a broadcaster. It was this huge interest you had. You read all the great books because of your influence of your friend Robert Hutchins, right? That great book story. You have in a sense written a symphony. You have had great interest in sailing around the world. You have had an interest in music, as I said. All these interests, I have never known whether Hugh Downs is any good at any of these things, or whether he's just, you know, the pure definition of a dilettante.
I am the world's champion dilettante, really. I dabble in all that stuff. And as a matter of fact, a wide range of interests makes me a generalist, and that sort of suits me to be anchoring a news magazine, sure, I think, where you do features. Sure. But my wife defines a generalist as somebody who comes to know less and less about more and more until he knows nothing about everything, and that's about the condition I'm in.
Well, where does that come from, and how do you view that? That simply your mind is so interested in the world around you that you can't shut it down.
I remember that Alexander Wolcott said years ago. He said, "I'm interested in everything except incest and folk dancing." That kind of fits me. But it is true. A wide range of interests. And I don't know whether it may stem from the fact that my father, when I was 5 years old, said to me one time, and this I know accounts for my interest in science. I asked him how far away the moon was, yeah, and I remembered that he told me it was 238,000 miles away. I didn't have any idea what 238,000 miles was, but I was so flattered at being given a grown-up answer that sparked an interest in science that has grown ever since.
Now, you and Hutchins were friends?
Yes, I was the announcer on the NBC Radio University of Chicago Roundtable. Yeah. I was 22 years old, I think, and I sat there and listened to Mortimer Adler and Hutchins and those great scholars and everything. And
who else was there? Do you remember, other than Mortimer Adler? Hutchins, yeah. Adler wrote a whole series of books about philosophy.
Sure. There were others that I can't call to mind right now.
But it was called the Roundtable.
It was called the University of Chicago Roundtable on every Sunday afternoon.
And these smart people would sit around and talk about big ideas.
Right. And you couldn't help being educated just sitting there listening to him, you know. And then later, when Hutchins headed the Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions, I was invited to go out and be a fellow there. And in a room full of scholars, we discovered one time that Hutchins and I were the only two people in the room who had read all of the great books.
and he had actually coined the idea, had he not, of using the great books as an educational
alternative. St. John's University started that. And then when Britannica took it over, and after that incident I mentioned, Britannica asked me to join a group of scholars as advisors, including people like Daniel Bell and Father Hesburgh, and I'm one of those 17 that helped revise the great books. It was a rare privilege for me.
What are you best at?
I hope now that I'm best at, I've been developing a kind of a style of commentary, and this is one of the reasons that on abcnews.com I have a little thing called Insight, and that's gaining now in number of hits, and I'm getting a little better at it too. Yeah. Or write about anything, you know, that hits my mind. And on ABC Radio, the Perspective broadcast is very gratifying to me because those are essays of around 7-8 minutes, again, that you can do on radio, and mainstream television you don't do that anymore. You know, the commentary has almost vanished from that. The last one I remember was when John Chancellor did
commentary
that
at the end of his. When he did the news and did a commentary?
No, after he ceased to be the news anchor, he would come on and do a minute.
He did the Eric Severide kind of thing.
Yeah, right. And that's virtually vanished from mainstream television. And for that, that's one of the reasons I'm anxious to face these new challenges, because I will be doing that with the with a new website that Ampex has set up. Zynex TV has a thing that the address of which will be
Ampex?
Ampex. And what the website is called EXBTV, and you get on EXBTV.com. I'm starting on October 27th. What that is, that will cover the executive branch of our government the way C-SPAN has covered the legislative. And the icing on the cake for me is I will be I will get precises of everything that's happened through the week, and then do a general perspective on critical commentary about the executive branch of our government. I look forward to that with more zest than I can state.
Now, are you still doing a lot of scientific inquiry?
Yeah, a lot. Most of that in advanced theoretical physics has really grabbed me by the throat.
Advanced theoretical physics?
It's true, and so, I once said to Lloyd Mutz, I took a course in astrophysics at Columbia during the International Geophysical Year, and I said, should I go back to mathematical school and master tensor calculus so I would understand this? And Lloyd paid me a compliment. He said, you're asking the right questions. And I thought that was a good comment. And so I'm asking a lot of questions of Alan Guth and Robert Jastrow and those people, and have a kind of a massive correspondence, and gaining more and more insights into this mysterious universe we find ourselves in. It fascinates me.
Now that you are at this age and this place, I want to ask about a couple of personalities and then sort of, but first, any regrets? I mean, this has worked out pretty well for you. I mean, with your curiosity, broadcasting was a perfect place to be.
Really not any massive regrets, and I've learned in life that regrets come from the things you didn't do that you regretted.
Right.
The others are mistakes, and you know, I've made a lot of mistakes, but that's different from regretting.
Right. What would that be then? What mistake?
Well, I couldn't list all of them. I mean, the mistakes.
Is there a big one?
No. Oh, no, I can't really think of a big mistake I made, like taking a wrong turn in life or being in the wrong profession.
But when you left the Today Show, when you look back, was there a moment that you said,
yes.
I mean, beyond the first month away, when you sort of say, you get up in the morning and say, where's my microphone, and it's not there?
Well, I'll tell you, one thing that happened to me was, after some months, I guess I naively thought that the broadcasting world would beat a path to my door and try to get me back in, and I found that was not happening. And I thought maybe I was through with broadcasting. But
and then Rune came back.
The great luck for Rune Arledge to tap me for 2020.
Why did Rune think of you?
I guess because I was in town and he knew I was substituting for a Good Morning America week on Good Morning America. He had seen me that morning, and he was casting about how to replace the anchoring situation. Yeah.
And he wanted something that was familiar and comfortable for the audience.
When I got a message that he was trying to get me by phone, I had seen the premiere of 2020, and I knew that he wasn't calling me to take over Monday Night Football. I knew what he was calling
me. Oh, that would be fun, though.
And it was. Yeah. But one thing I have to tell you about Rune, I had great trepidation. It was a wonderful opportunity, but I thought, are they asking me to come in and help them paper over a disaster that they're going to quietly fold after some weeks? And then I'd be hung with the loss, and I could hear the critics saying, here's another has-been trying to make a comeback. Mm-hmm. And I asked Rune if it could be kept on for at least 2 years, because I'd need that much time to try to get it off the runway, and if I could have access to the entire machinery of ABC News. I didn't want to be an isolated unit competing with ABC News. He kept both those promises.
Now, was the executive producer Newfield from the beginning?
No. Victor came in later. He was the best thing that happened to the program, I think. Victor has an unerring sense of how to get something across to the public that's meaningful to them, and he's done a hell of a job.
And Rune, how would you characterize Rune?
Rune's amazing. You know, he's a genius. Here's the guy who made ABC the number one sports network, and then the number one news network,
right,
who doesn't return phone calls. Tradition, that's a joke about him. He returned a call of mine once and in the 21 years, and I think that was because his secretary dialed a wrong number.
Did you ever ask him why he doesn't?
I don't know. He operates in a way like
an
agency.
Call him to return the phone call?
There was a guy I know who was a very successful guy with one of the major advertising agencies, and he lived this. He said, if I ever get a memo that's marked urgent, I put it under the blotter on my desk, and I find in 2 weeks it isn't urgent anymore. And goes home with a clear briefcase and everything. It was very successful. So apparently it can be done, and maybe it's been exaggerated. I'm sure Rune has...
No, I've heard the same thing from lots of other people over at ABC. Jack Parr.
Jack Parr was a remarkable... That 5 years I cherished, because he created a fierce spotlight, and a lot of it slopped over onto me and did me a lot of good career-wise. But Parr was a strange guy. He was terribly nervous and not happy with the result of how he had carried off the program. If it bombed, he hurt badly from it, and if it was successful, he was suspicious of it. And I had a ball those 5 years, because I didn't have the responsibility. But he was never jealous of anybody else's success, and he was real. He never hippodromed anything, you know. He violated the Pagliacci tradition of the clown is supposed to laugh if his heart is breaking, and if his heart was breaking, he cried. So that honesty made people say, what's Jack Parr really like? They couldn't quite believe it.
Yeah, it was the unpredictability that Parr brought,
yeah,
as well as the sense of his curiosity, like yours, extended across.
I mean, sure.
His friends on the show were Robert Kennedy and John Kennedy and Richard Nixon and Alexander King. I mean, all those people who came to that show. There was not only the family, which you were part of, but also all the other people.
And a very eclectic range. You're right. One time, Harlow Shapley, the great astronomer, was on, and Parr asked a wonderful, I would never have thought to ask this. He said to Shapley, you've turned a telescope on all directions on the heavens. Is there a God? Yeah. That's a wonderful question. And Shapley took about 5 minutes to explain his theology, which was fairly complex, but it was a great question to ask an astronomer.
Are you going to miss it?
Yeah, I'm sure I'll miss it. I'll miss some of the aspects of the public, my relation to a public. I went through that once before. When I left Today, I felt like that one day, a week afterward, I saw something on the program that was wrong, and I thought, I got to correct that tomorrow. And I thought, I can't correct it. You know, I have clipped the wires on my loud hailer.
Yeah.
And then I adjusted to that fairly soon, but I think I'll miss.
I assume Johnny Carson has been able to. I mean, I know everybody wants him to come back, and evidently he has had some health problems in the last 6 months.
But he's better now.
Yeah, I understand he is too.
Glad.
But here's a guy who evidently walked away and said, "I've done my best. I'm out of here," and has resisted every effort.
There are people who do that, and people who don't. You know, in the opera world. Enrico Caruso did it the hard way because he died at the height of his. But there were singers like.
That's the easy way.
Yeah, I'm afraid, yeah. But those who really, really quit and then turn to other things, I think it's a healthier way to do than if you can't let go of it.
A couple of sort of locker room questions. Other than Stephen Hawking, who's the smartest person you ever came in contact with?
Ooh, smartest outside of Hawking. I would have said Hawking hands down right off. It sounds odd, but ABC's science editor, Michael Gillen, is a man of enormous depth and intellect. I've really enjoyed talking to him. He popularizes science and does it accurately, but when you're having a conversation with him, he can get into the heavy stuff, the stratospheric stuff, and I'm always pleased to have a chance to chat with him about it. He might be, he's the first one that comes to mind.
And the most biggest talent you've ever seen?
Probably Sammy Davis Jr.
Really?
Yeah. The versatility and the speed, and even little things like in Las Vegas in a fast draw contest, his reflexes were faster than anybody his age. He's an amazing, amazing guy.
Hugh Downs leaving 2020 this Friday. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Charlie.
Pleasure.
Always a pleasure.
Thank you for joining us. See you next time.
A production of WNET, New York.
Where can you find millions of books online? BarnesandNoble.com.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
DLJ Direct is proud to underwrite Charlie Rose. DLJ Direct, the thinking of a Wall Street investment bank combined with the speed of the internet. Donaldson, Lufkin, and Jenrette, putting our reputation on line.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
On the next Charlie Rose, Susan Faludi, a feminist writer who came to our attention years ago with a new book about the plight of men. Join us.